Little Mary Phagan left her home one day. She went to the pencil factory to get her weekly pay. Left her home at 11, kissed her mother goodbye. Not one time did the poor girl think she was going to die. Leo Frankie met her with a brutish heart, we know. He smiled and said, "Little Mary, you won't go home no more."
Read the sheriff! Sheriff, the sergeant here! Read the sheriff! Read what Frank does to that little girl!
For the rich and another for us common people?
No!
Are we to submit to the murder of a Georgia girl at the hands of a Yankee?
No!
Is the justice to be sold for Jew money?
No!
Who? I ask you, who?
All rise.
People against Leo A. Frank, charged with murder. I'm informed the jury has reached a verdict, and I've ordered the courtroom cleared in order to receive it. Let the record show that the defendant and his counsel are voluntarily absent at this time. Mr. Dawson.
Well, may it please the court. The state is concerned that the absence of the defendant, as this verdict is received, may constitute a grounds for reversal.
Let me make this clear. I requested that the defense and his counsel not be physically present at the verdict solely because of the possibility of violence in the event of an acquittal.
Well, nonetheless...
I had not finished, Mr. Dawson. In spite of my own feeling, I informed the defendant and his counsel that he had an absolute right to be present, and that the court would, if he exercised that right, guarantee his safety, whatever the cost. His absence is thus voluntary and constitutes a waiver of any right to be present. Mr. Rudd, you may bring in the jury. Judge Powell, may I speak with you for a moment? Main entrance guarded?
There's a cordon of deputies. Judge, aren't you sort of exaggerating the possibility of violence? Oh, I'll grant you, they could get ugly if Frank was acquitted. But he isn't going to be acquitted.
I'm not so sure.
If those jurors weren't on the panel, they'd be right out there in the street with that mob.
Perhaps. There's something about serving on a jury. To me, the man's innocence has been demonstrated to a mathematical certainty.
Versus Leo A. Frank, charged with murder. We, the jury, in the above action, find the defendant guilty.
The defense would wish the jury polled, and this will now be done. Mr. Foreman?
Guilty.
Juror number two?
Guilty.
This case did not end with a verdict. 2 years later, the governor of Georgia, John Slaton, was to become involved with the most controversial decision of his administration.
It also causes a man's horses to jump poorly.
And why are you going to stay in it?
What makes you think I will?
I know you will. I'm your wife. And I didn't marry you to change you.
Well, the choice may not be mine. My term ends next month.
That only means you'll be out of office next month.
Exactly. But not out of politics. Now, a lot of people voted for you for the Senate.
A man's not supposed to seek a senatorship. I don't know why. But I suppose if there were ever any public clamor for me to serve in the Senate, I would answer the call. And if there were no clamor, perhaps we could arrange for some. Fact remains that I did not get enough votes this time.
Well, you got more than anyone else.
Yes, but not a majority. And the convention rules on that.
It wasn't the people that ganged up on you in that convention. It was Tom Watson and that wool hat rabble.
Why did he do that? He supported you when you ran for governor.
He said that I would govern without fear or favor. And he turned against me because I did. Oh, he has a big following, Watson does, bigger than mine.
All right, so Tom Watson gets them excited. But you saw to it that the kids in the back counties will have a better education than their folks did.
Regrettably, their folks still do the voting.
They'll learn. And those kids will be voting soon.
And I'll be around when that happens. That's what you want to hear, isn't it? That I mean to stay in Georgia politics as long as Georgia will have me? All right. Now that you've softened me up with flattery, perhaps we can take up what you really came here for. Am I right?
It's Leo Frank.
My half the state is hollering for Leo Frank's blood. And that commission's going to let that death sentence stand.
And that puts it in your lap.
In the governor's lap.
You're the governor.
For just over 2 weeks. And a man has 30 days in which to prepare an appeal from a prison commission ruling. You didn't think I knew that, did you? Oh, I do a little research on my own now and again.
Suppose he doesn't wait until Harris takes office as governor. Suppose he appeals to you today.
Then his lawyers would be giving up a month they could spend working on the appeal. He'd be giving up a month of his life.
He'd be gambling a month of his life on the possibility that you'd give him a better shake than Harris would.
That's a poor gamble.
Maybe. Maybe not. Jack, I would like to know what you would do if you got the Leo Frank case, because I think you will get it. And I claim a brother-in-law's privilege to try and talk you out of it.
You're wrong there.
Not that I have ever talked you out of anything.
Wrong about what?
Wrong about what I would do, because I don't know that myself. I'm probably the only man in Georgia who can read, who doesn't have a firm opinion one way or the other about what should be done with Leo Frank. The only man who doesn't know what he'd do if he were governor is the governor.
Then when the appeal reaches you...
If it reaches me.
If, then?
If it reaches me, I'll take it under advisement. If I feel that I can reach a firm decision in time, I'll act. If not, I'll just leave it on my desk for my successor, Governor Harris.
Governor, I doubt that you have time to review the case properly.
I agree.
Now you're talking.
But I would have time to try. And in the meantime, there are several hundred thousand other citizens of this state whose problems might demand my attention. You'll excuse me. The federal income tax, now enacted, will not long remain at 2%. Just a minute. Therefore, Senator, I urge you very strongly. Come in.
I'm sorry, Governor, but this is important.
Well, everything's important, Martin, even the income tax.
It's happened, Governor.
What?
The prison board turned Frank down. He's making his appeal to you now. Let me take this back to his lawyer. You got 16 days in office. There isn't time.
I told you, Martin, I won't do that.
I was hoping you'd change your mind.
But you knew I wouldn't. Who's out there? You came in as if hotly pursued by the hounds of Hades. I was just wondering which particular hound.
Tom Watson.
What does he want? Frank case. Tom Watson claims to be the poor man's friend. Why is it he never came to see me about farm-to-market roads? Where was he when I was trying to get the state to help the rural schools?
I'll get rid of him?
He's done more harm to the state of Georgia than any man since William Tecumseh Sherman.
I'll tell him that you're too busy.
Unfortunately, I'm still the governor, and the governor can never be too busy to see his enemies.
Yeah,
show him in.
You'll never see him if you...
Show him in. You can go, Michael. I don't think Watson wants a record of his remarks. I know I don't. Come in, Mr. Watson. Come in. These gentlemen are just leaving. Thank you, gentlemen.
How are you, Governor?
Busy, Mr. Watson, busy.
Yeah, I expect so, Governor. I expect so. I hadn't seen you since convention time.
Yes, I remember.
I hated to do it to you. No, I didn't. I loved doing it to you. Nothing I like better than putting a spoke in the wheel of a bigoted politician got himself all puffed up like a frog. But I was sorry it was you. That's the truth.
Is it?
Yeah, I mean, you're an aristocrat, too big for your britches, but you've been a good governor in a quiet sort of way.
That's tautological, isn't it? A good governor?
I know what tautological means. You think a good governor should be quiet, don't you? That's your opinion. I think a great governor just might make quite a commotion.
But you've been a good one. You've been a good one.
Please get to the point.
The point is, United States Senate.
Are you offering me some kind of a deal?
No, I can't make no deals. Anybody accepts my support becomes unclean. You know what the Atlanta Constitution said about my support? Lie down with dogs, get up with fleas.
Yes, I rather like that editorial.
I thought you would. But, Governor, even if I can't support anybody, I can oppose. And when I oppose, my people oppose.
thousands of them. Farmers with empty bellies got more votes in the family than shoes. When they read in my paper that a man is a scalawag, a limberback, a tool of the interest, ought to be run out of public life. They run him out. They vote him out.
I reckon it debates the extent of your power over the mob.
That's good. Just as long as you understand that it exists. Just as long as you understand that it can put you in the Senate. Or it can destroy you. Are you listening to me?
Yes, for the moment.
That's good. Now, let me see. You don't read my paper, do you, the Jeffersonian?
I wouldn't have that.
Of course not. It's written for the great unwashed. You bathe too often, which is to your credit, of course. But I was hoping you might have read some of my coverage of the Frank case.
I haven't.
I have devoted most of my paper to it for the last 2 years since the trial. The point is, Governor, he's guilty. But he's got important friends.
His friends don't interest me.
They got to Judge Rowan. Late Judge Rowan, who presided at the Frank trial, who sentenced him to die, wrote a letter to the prison board just before he died, urging clemency, indicating doubts. They reached him, Governor. He is old and sick and tired, and they reached him.
They?
Sure, they did. I explained it all in the Jeffersonian. Even before the verdict, Judge Rowan told Judge Powell in the courtroom that he knew Frank to be innocent, and still he sentenced him to hang. But then years later, he wrote that letter. Now, what does that add up to?
Why don't you tell me?
All right, I will. It adds up to a judge wavering back and forth between those that are trying to reach him and his plain duty.
That's your interpretation.
Thousands of people know it for the truth. But what they want to know is, can the governor be reached? Will he consider a case he has no right to consider?
Now, what is that supposed to mean?
I thought that might interest you. Frankly, Governor, I'm surprised. I am surprised that a man of your discretion would even contemplate ruling on a matter in which he has a personal involvement. What was the name of your law firm?
Rosser, Slaton, Phillips, and Hopkins. But that doesn't...
Now, that would be Luther Rosser, wouldn't it? Luther Z. Rosser.
Yes, that's
Luther
right.
Ziegler Rosser, who represented Frank at his trial.
That partnership does not become effective until my term as governor expires.
Well, now, that's strange. That's very strange, because your name is on his stationery right now, on his office door.
Mr. Watson.
I stopped in on my way down, took a look.
I was not a member of the firm at the time of the trial. I am not a member of the firm now. And you and I know it.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's right. You know it and I know it. And a few other people know it.
But hundreds of thousands of people don't. They will believe, in the event that you permit yourself to consider this application, they will believe that in hiring Slaton and Rosser, Frank bought himself a lawyer to appear in court and the services of the senior partner...
They will believe no such thing.
They will believe it if they read my paper.
Don't threaten me, sir.
Wouldn't dream of it, Governor, but I'm trying to help you.
Bully!
Governor, the Frank case ain't gonna make you any friends in this state. I promise you, if you fight me on this...
Get him out of here!
...throwing politics in the state of Georgia... Are you out of your mind? I'm going. But I showed you the easy way. Does you remember that, Governor?
Well, what was that all about?
Just what it sounded like. A lot of promises, threats and nonsense.
What did he mean by the easy way?
He meant I could disqualify myself from hearing the Frank appeal. Luther Ross is going to be my law partner.
Yeah, but not until after your term's over.
Oh, yes, but I could argue that even the appearance of a conflict of interest, he's right, would be easy.
And the other way he'd make it appear that Frank...
He would. He made that quite clear.
Governor, I think he got under your skin.
Yes, he did. I think I'll go down to the athletic club and have myself a nice hot steam bath.
And the Frank case?
I'll start studying the application and the record this afternoon. You set up a public hearing for tomorrow.
Is that wise, Governor?
It's the essence of wisdom. If you do what the people at a hearing say, then they felt they had a part in the decision. If you go against them, at least you gave them a chance to blow off steam. Besides, there's always the off possibility that you might learn something.
I'll make the arrangements.
Before the hearing, I want to talk to Judge Powell. And Martin, don't look so sad. Leo Frank may be the most hated man in Georgia, but that does not make him innocent of the murder of Mary Phagan.
It doesn't make him guilty either.
No. No, it doesn't. I have a high regard for jury verdicts, even when Tom Watson agrees with them. Oh, I think I'm going to let this one stand unless I find powerful reasons not to, and find them before my term expires.
May I say that I hope you don't?
You may. Judge, I have to ask you a question now at which I hope you will not take offense. Is it possible that either at the time you refer to, or perhaps later on when he wrote his letter to the prison commission, that Judge Roan was responding to some corrupt influence?
Absolutely not. And I know of no one in this state who could make so foul a suggestion. Except for Tom Watson.
Thank you very much, Judge. You've been most helpful.
Leonard Roan corrupted? Now, Governor, I'd just as soon believe it of you.
So would Tom Watson, Judge. So would Tom Watson.
Thou shalt not kill. To this commandment, there are no exceptions. I ask for mercy. Not just for Leo Frank, but for us. Who will, if the state takes his life, share the awful responsibility of disobeying God's revealed command?
This is not North against South. Tennessee and Texas are southern states. Yet their legislatures have urged that the death sentence of Leo Frank be commuted.
I read in the papers, Governor, where you might let him off on account of his lawyer and you were partners. And I read where you say that that ain't so. Well, Governor, all of us around Marietta say that there's only one way you can show us that that ain't so.
We of the prison board turned down Frank's appeal because it was an appeal for mercy. And the murder of an innocent young girl by a grown man does not deserve mercy. The commission had no right to interfere with the work of the court. And, Governor, intending no disrespect, but you got no more right to tamper with what the jury done than they got coming in your office telling you how to be governor.
To go home, Governor?
Not quite. I want to theorize. Only a man can't do that without someone listening to his theories, so I guess you're elected. Sit down.
Governor, couldn't this wait until morning?
And keep quiet. Now, what is the issue here?
Oh, we all know what the issue
is. Keep quiet. I'm theorizing. What is the issue? is it mercy? This was an unspeakable crime, and the man who did it deserves no mercy. But do we know that Leo Frank did it? This is the case. Mary Phagan went to the pencil factory on a holiday afternoon to collect her pay. There were three men in the building at the time. There was Leo Frank, the superintendent, Jim Connolly, the sweeper, and Newt Lee, the watchman. That night, the girl's body was found. Frank says that he gave her her pay around noon, that she left his office, and that was the last he saw of her. Connolly says that Frank asked him to stand guard downstairs while the girl was in his office, and that afterwards, Frank admitted that he had made advances toward the girl, that she had resisted his advances, that he killed her. Connolly says that Frank showed him the girl's body on the factory floor and then bribed him to help him carry the body down to the basement where it was later found, and to write certain notes putting the blame on Newt Lee. Now, the jury had a choice. Believe Connolly or believe Leo Frank?
Yeah, the jury believed Connolly.
Right. And they had more than just Connolly's words. They saw and heard him when he said those words. They could observe his manner, his posture, his tones. I only have the printed record. But I also have this. To me, the man's innocence has been demonstrated to a mathematical certainty. What did Judge Roan mean by that? Quickly now.
Well, that as he interpreted the testimony, Frank.
No, the evidence could not possibly be interpreted to prove Frank's innocence.
Well, any good lawyer.
Oh, you could put it together so that it failed to prove his guilt. But apparently, in this case, that was not enough.
Well, perhaps he was a little inexact.
Judge Roan was very careful with his words, very careful. Could he have meant something else?
I don't think I follow you.
To me, the man's innocence has been demonstrated. Not to the jury, not in court, but to me. To me, it has been demonstrated may mean that I know something that you don't know. Could Judge Roan have known something that proved Frank's innocence?
It would have been his duty to speak out.
Not necessarily. I can imagine a situation where a judge might know a defendant was innocent, might even know that another man had committed the crime, and yet be forbidden to speak out.
No, silence in such a case would be an act of obstruction.
Have you never heard of privilege? Have you never heard of a witness admitting to his attorney that the testimony he gave in court was a lie? May that attorney reveal that communication? Certainly not. However, with a man's life at stake, might his attorney disclose that to the judge?
He shouldn't.
But he might.
Well, if we're talking about Connolly, we don't even know whether he had an attorney.
But we don't know anything. And with Judge Roan dead, the only thing we can do is theorize. But Connolly was the first man the police suspected of the crime, and he probably did have a lawyer. If he did, I want that lawyer at Buckhead the first thing in the morning. I want you and John Grant there, too.
Governor, it's the middle of the night.
Well, then you haven't got much time.
You all put me in a very difficult position, Governor.
Events have placed both of us in a very difficult position, sir. You must be the judge of your conscience. I will be the judge of mine. Did you represent Jim Connolly in the Leo Frank case? That is the death of Mary Phagan.
I did.
Now, sir, without violating any communication, any confidential communication, that is, between lawyer and client, am I correct in assuming that as his lawyer, you conferred with him from time to time?
That is correct, sir.
Was one of those conferences of greater importance than any of the others? Was it so important that you later felt you had to impart certain information to Judge Roan? And did you tell Judge Roan,
Governor,
that Connolly had given you a statement directly in variance with his testimony at the trial? Mr. Wheeler, did Connolly tell you that he had committed the crime? Was he a drinking man? Was he too drunk to remember?
Did he tell you that he might have done it? That Leo Frank did not?
I'm sorry, Governor. You'll have to excuse me.
Very well, Mr. Wheeler. Very well. Thank you very much for coming down here. Certainly appreciate it, Governor.
Well? You were right, Jack. Conley lied.
Yes, but when?
What do you mean?
All we can say is that Conley probably told two stories. One to his lawyer, the other one later, in court.
And his testimony was a lie.
No, one of his stories was a lie. I'm going to reread Conley's testimony, and then we'll go out to the factory and see if the story Conley told in court could have been the truth.
Now, Jack, is that wise? Now, how would it look for the
government? We've only known each other 30 years. I suppose in another 30 years, you'll come to understand that I really don't much care how things look.
Well, now, Jack, I didn't mean to...
Of course you didn't. And a howling mob will make our work impossible, so I suggest we get out there when we won't attract too much attention. Question. You were down in the cellar? Answer by Conley. Yes, sir. And Mr. Frank was up over my head stamping. So I locked the door and sat on the box, and the next thing I heard was Mr. Frank whistling. So I went and unlocked the door, just like he said, and went up the steps. Now, according to Conley, Frank told him that he's tried to be with the little girl, and she refused me. And I struck her, and she hit her head, and I don't know how bad she got hurt.
You can hear everything, the stomps and the whistles. That sounds like the inside of a bass drum.
Now, Frank sent Conley to have a look, and Conley says that he found the body right about here. And let's see now. And he banged her head against the first machine, and she was quiet and didn't move no more. Question. Doctor, did you make an analysis of that dark stain found at the foot of that machine, and what did that analysis reveal? Answer. I did. And it revealed a substance I believe to be blood.
Well, it all fits in so far.
Yes. Now, as far as blood is concerned, it was only a tiny spot, and the testimony revealed that these machines were dangerous, so the blood could have come from an accident.
Or Mary Fagan's murder.
Yes. Yeah, Conley's testimony again. I got a piece of cotton cloth, and I put it around the girl. Her hands went down easy. I picked her up in the cloth just like a person that was going to give out the clothes on Monday. Four corners tied together. Conley talks about how heavy the girl was and how it took the both of them to get her into the elevator. And he says, Mr. Frank unlocked the elevator, and the elevator went down to the basement.
Still possible.
Maybe. On that elevator to stop it at the basement. Now, there's even testimony at the trial. There's that policeman. What's his name here? Yeah, Officer Lassiter. The elevator comes down and hits the ground plumb at the bottom of the basement. There was no blood in that elevator.
Well, maybe it was cleaned.
No, no, both sides agree that nothing ever got cleaned around this factory.
Well, do we know she bled?
Well, we know she had a scalp wound on the left side of her head about 2.5 inches long, through the scalp to the skull.
Well, maybe rigor mortis had already set
in. No. Conley said her hands went down easy. And there was blood in the cellar. Not just a spot or two to argue about the way there was upstairs, but lots of it. Now, to believe Conley's story, you must believe that that body came down in that elevator, wrapped like a laundry bundle in a single thickness of calico, took the same ride we just took without getting blood on that elevator. We already know that Conley told two stories. One has to be a lie. Now I think we know which one that is. The story that included the taking of Mary Phagan's body down in that elevator. The story he told in court. The story the jury believed. That was the lie.
Decided?
I have one more person to consult.
Jack. Jack, do you really think you can save Leo Frank's life?
I can commute a sentence.
But will the mob let him live? It seems to me that all you'll be doing is changing the place of his hanging from a gallows to a tree.
I don't think so.
Jack,
But even if I did, it would not affect my decision. The state cannot always control the mob, but God help us if the mob controls the state. Good night, John.
Good night, Jack.
Couldn't help overhearing you, too.
You aren't worried, I hope.
I suppose I am a little. I couldn't sleep.
Sit with me. I have to ask you something.
Have you decided?
It requires your consent.
Oh, no, the people elected you, Jack, not me.
Yes, but I believe I must now act in such a way that perhaps they will never again elect me to any office.
Well, that will be their loss.
Maybe. What I propose to do now may cause me the loss of my law practice. It will cause me the loss of my reputation. I have been told that it may cost me my life.
I know.
I doubt that it actually go that far, but there is a madness abroad in Georgia. In any event, I will be risking a great deal that is not really mine alone to risk.
You think I might forbid it?
Well, that's your right.
No, you must do whatever you think is right. I wouldn't stop you if I could. I'd rather be the widow of a brave man than the wife of a coward.
Sorry.
Now, hush. You've asked me and I've answered, and let's not ever speak of it again. Come to bed.
Would you ring Sheriff Mangum, please? Sheriff, Governor Slaton speaking. I hate to disturb you this time of night, but it's essential that a prisoner be transferred from Atlanta up to the state farm, and it must be done quickly and quietly. Yes, I'll supply you with a written order. Thank you. Responsibility rests where the power is reposed. Judge Roan calls to me from another world to do that which he should have done. I can endure misconstruction, abuse, and condemnation. But I cannot stand the constant companionship of an accusing conscience. This case has been marked by doubt. The trial judges doubted. Two judges of the Supreme Court of the state of Georgia doubted. Two judges of the United States Supreme Court doubted. One of the three prison commissioners doubted. Acting in accordance with what I believe to be my duty under the circumstances, it is ordered that the sentence of Leo Frank is commuted from the death penalty to imprisonment for life. It's 21st day of June, 1915, John M. Slaton, Governor.
Be parked at the side entrance.
When the governor leaves the state house for the last time, he does not go by the back door.
Now, Jack, don't be foolhardy. Do you propose to walk down those steps?
The governor of Georgia's always left by the main steps, sir. Governor?
Terrible time getting through the building. There are people everywhere.
So I've heard.
Nathaniel Harris, place your hand on the book. Do you, Nathaniel Harris, solemnly swear that you will faithfully execute the office of the governor of the state of Georgia, and that you will, to the best of your ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution thereof and the Constitution of the United States of America?
I so swear.
Governor Slaton.
The extent of the damage is that broken window. Some drunk did that this afternoon.
You were not here?
No, I had a speaking engagement at a luncheon in Atlanta.
You kept it?
Of course.
You might have been killed. That mob is uncontrollable.
Judge, I am aware that there is a mob, and I suppose that it may kill me, though I doubt that it will. I will not, however, under any circumstances, join the mob.
No, no one suggested any such thing as your joining them.
To the extent that I change the course of my actions suit the mob, I become part of it. Like a little more coffee, Judge?
Thank you.
Judge, you're not... I believe you're armed.
Indeed I am, sir. As is every man in this room, yourself excepted.
Well, I doubt there's any law against it.
On the contrary. Prudence requires that his friends protect a man who refuses to protect himself. Even so, it is fortunate that you are not spending the summer in Georgia.
Well, Sally and I take a trip every summer.
May I ask when you expect to leave?
Thursday. We made arrangements months ago.
Would you consider leaving tomorrow?
I certainly would not, Judge.
Jack, please. The judge is just trying to help.
Can no one understand that I must be the master of my own life? Half my friends tell me to leave the state at once. The others tell me I should not leave at all. Stay and fight, Jack. You can show them.
Please.
People of Georgia gave me certain powers, and they paid me for my judgment in using them. Now, some of them may regret what they did. That's their privilege. And they're right. But it does not entitle them to make my plans for me. I will leave exactly when I had arranged to leave.
What's that?
They've been storming around Atlanta all evening. Apparently, they finally got up enough nerve to come here. Now, Jack, where are you going?
I'm going out there to talk to them.
Jack.
Well, they can't all be crazy. I mean, some of them must have voted for me.
But they are all insane. Temporarily, perhaps, but nonetheless uncontrollably insane. Well, no one can talk to them now.
Has anyone tried?
The state guard will handle them, Governor.
Guard? I gave strict orders for the guard not to be called.
In the first place, your power over the guard ended with your term of office. In the second place, no orders were needed. Now, this is their regular drill night. The officers chose to hold that drill in the field next to your main gate. Well, that mob should be there just about now.
Every man proved to be engaged in the lynching should be treated as a murderer. Any man who approves the lynching is no true Georgian and should be driven from the state, as should any newspaper which condones this utter disgrace to civilization.
Governor, when you commuted Frank's sentence, you said you were saving Georgia from a stain that could never be eradicated. Do you still feel that way?
I most certainly do.
Well, isn't Frank just as dead? Wasn't his death even more horrible?
I am ashamed. Every true Georgian must be deeply ashamed that this lynching did take place. But his execution by the state would have been something far more shameful.
You'll have to make it plainer than that.
Very well. Brutal as these words may sound, for Frank to have been hanged by the state of Georgia would have been worse than that he was lynched by a mob. Lynching strikes at the body of civilization. Execution without proper cause strikes at the soul. That plain enough?
To permit the death of an innocent man was unthinkable to Governor Slaton. An outright pardon would have required the disclosure of privileged information. So the course he chose was a just one. John Marshall Slaton returned to Georgia as he had planned, but his unpopular decision of June 21st, 1915, left him entirely without support. Tom Watson was elected to the Senate. John Slaton spent the last half of his life in political obscurity.
These stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.
The use of this additional story of a courageous American was approved by President Kennedy for this series. In a moment, a preview of the next episode.